on some morning when I stand in God's wonderful city, where the light of heaven's glory shall never grow dim. When I shake hands with the Savior who gave life eternal, I'd like to talk it over with Him. I'd like to kneel down and talk it all over with Him. I'd like to
I'm so glad for the goodness and the greatness of God, for His mercy and for His grace. We want to continue to remember Brother Roscoe and Wilda in her prayers. They're still not up to par. And so I need to pray that God will reach down and touch them. And there's a lot of people that stands in need of prayer this evening. And so we're going to pray in a little bit. that God would just reach out and touch him. But we want to thank you for standing by us and giving us the things that we need as we journey along. And we want to say thanks to Ronnie and Cynthia. Mama, we just thank God for friends and loved ones that helps us out along life's way. And we're glad that they enjoy the broadcast. You know, that's the reason that we're here. I know there's a lot of people that they think that I'm a little bit rough at times whenever I preach. But, you know, I believe that God's called me. And that's the only way that I know how to do it, is just what God gives me. And so, I'm glad that God gives me the message. I believe in these last days, I believe God has gave me the message for the church. Why? Because the church has slacked down over the years. And it seems like there's so many. My, that you wouldn't really know there's a church if you didn't look at the name over top of the door whenever you went in. You wouldn't know what was going on. And so I'm glad that I'm a child of the King. And when Jesus blesses me, I get excited about it. Sometimes I jump up and down. Sometimes I take a running fit. I bet you know, yes, there had been a time or two that I caught myself going out the door whenever I was preaching. And so you see, I'm glad that God is still God. And he doesn't love me any more than he loves you. Not a bit more. And so I'm glad that today's a day of salvation. And if you don't know Jesus, we'd like for you to get acquainted with him, because he's the best friend that anybody could ever have. And he's the only one that we want whenever it comes time to leave this old world. We want to know that he's got a hold of our hand. And he'll lead us through. He'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. He says, lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the age. And so today is the day that Jesus has given us to call on his name. Ask him, Lord, what's in my life? Is there joy? Is there peace? Is there contentment in my life, or am I always in a turmoil? I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. I don't know where to go. I'm so glad that God gave me a witness. Whenever he saved me, he gave me a witness. He gave me a story to tell. And I'm glad that I never have forgot it, and I never will forget it as long as I'm here on this old earth. I'll not forget what God gave me. Well, because I watched a lot of old people, and I say that with lots of respect. I watched a lot of older people, and you know, I watch them shout up and down the aisles. I know everybody don't shout. I had a granddad that didn't shout. He'd sit and laugh until he'd shake the whole church. Then you could feel it vibrating. And so I'm glad for the goodness and the greatness of God. And so you just pray that God would use us as an instrument. His love and his spirit could flow through. And I thank God that the letters that we get, that people enjoy the broadcast. One lady says, I was about ready to give up until I got listening to you fellows on Monday or Sunday morning. She picks it up on Sunday morning. And she said, preacher, I'm glad that you're there, because you're just what I needed. And so you see, God knows what we need. A lot of times we don't even know, but God knows exactly what we need. And so you pray for us. And again, don't forget to pray for Roscoe and Wilda, that God would reach down and touch them. We miss them. Also, I know people will write and they'll say, where's Roscoe and Wilda at? We miss. I know you do. We do too. And so we want to pray with you and pray for you that God would just bless you. Father, in the name of Jesus, reach out today. Touch those under the sound of her voice. might they feel the anointing of the Holy Spirit flowing across the airwaves. Because God, you're no respecter of person. You want to encourage people. Just to lift up their hands and praise you and thank you. And because you're God and there is none like you. You said you inhabit the praises of your people. And so I thank you, Father. Now, Father, have your way in our hearts, in our lives. Give us that which we need. Touch those, Father, that are sick. Those that are afflicted. Might that healing virtue flow through. And it would touch people's hearts. It would touch people's bodies. Heavenly Father, they could be set free from the pain and the misery that they have. And we'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. All right. I'm Brother Ron Lauder going to come and sing for us.
I'm using my Bible for a road map. Ten commandments, they tell me what to do. The 12 disciples are my road signs,
yes.
And Jesus will take me safely through. Along there'll be no detours in heaven.
I got the second word.
No rough roads along the way. I'm using my Bible for a road map. My last stop is heaven someday. I'm using my Bible for a road map. The children of Israel used it too. They crossed the Red Sea of destruction, where God was there to see them through. There'll be no detours in heaven, no rough roads along the way. I'm using my Bible for a road map. My last stop is heaven some sweet day. Hence I've used my Bible for a road map. I've been traveling towards the promised land. There has been no worry or obstruction, no rough pavement and no sinking sand. I'm on the right road to glory. Jesus leads me by the hand. Since I've used my Bible for a road map, all my earthly travels have been grand. Since I've used my Bible for a road map, I've been shored by Jesus day and night. And if I take the wrong direction, my Bible will always steer me right. I'm on the right road to glory. Jesus leads me by the hand. Since I've used my Bible for a road map, all my earthly travels have been grand.
Praise God. I would grant you, if you use your Bible for a road map, you won't have near as many problems, near as many heartache, near as many sorrows. Thank you for that marvelous old song. Praise God. I want to read some scripture tonight, and this is found in 2 Peter, chapter number 1. You pray that God would just have his way in our hearts and in our lives, because we can do nothing without him. With him, all things are possible. But without him, nothing goes right. We just get all in a tizzy. 2 Peter, chapter 1, starting with verse number 1. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them who have obtained like precious faith with us. Through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. May God add his richest blessing to the reading of his word. We might read some more directly, and then again, we might not. As we look at this scripture, I want you to think about it, because whenever we read the word of God, we need to meditate on it. We need to think, how does that fit in? Because he's talking about, he says, Simon Peter, a servant of Jesus Christ. Now you stop and think, he put a servant before that he put his call to God, with Jesus. Why? Because a servant is a slave. And he was a slave for Jesus Christ. Jesus called him, and he knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus had called him. He's the one that even looked and said, when Jesus asked the question, who do people say that I am? Some say you're Elijah or Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And Jesus looked at him and he said, who do you say that I am? And Peter says, you're Jesus, the Christ. You are the Son of God. And Jesus looked at him and he says, Simon, flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. And so you see, when Jesus calls us, he gives us a witness, a testimony. I've never forgot that whenever I dedicated my life to God, on the 14th day of December, 1967. Oh, I tried it several times before then, but it didn't stick. But that Sunday morning, as I knelt down there at the altar, I made a vow. I said, God, I'm here to stay. I'm not leaving anymore. You see, God wants us to have a determination. A determination. Now, the devil done everything that he could to upset me, to get me to quit, but I didn't quit. And I found out, honey, if you don't quit, God won't quit. He'll be there. I don't care how many times you stumble, how many times you fall. If you get up, you'll find out that he's right there for you to lean on. Why? Because he made us a promise. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. Lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. And so you see, Peter, this great man that God called and anointed with the Holy Ghost and fire. And Peter went forth, preaching. God used him in a mighty way. We could see that on the day of Pentecost, yes, I expect any of them could have preached on that day, but God chose Peter. And Peter preached the inaugural sermon on the day that the Holy Ghost fell and baptized the church. And so you see, yes, And it wasn't an easy sermon that Peter preached. Why? Because he was preaching to his own people. But he realized, that God was the one that was giving him the message. And as he looked at him, he says, now you have crucified the Lord of glory. You've nailed Jesus to the cross, and he's the one, the only one, that come to seek and to save those that were lost. Nobody else can do it. It takes Jesus. Nobody else can save you. I've had people to come up to me and say, "Preacher, I'd like for you to save me." I said, "I'm sorry, I can't do it. But I know somebody that can. I'll pray with you, and I'll do everything that I can to help you, but I can't save you." It takes Jesus. You see, he paid a price for us on the cross of Calvary that we could have life and have it more abundantly. He said, in John 3:17, he says that Jesus, God didn't send his son to come into this world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And so you see, God wants people saved. He doesn't want nobody lost. He wants to save people. And so you see, we need to come to him. As he was writing this letter, yes, he said, I'm writing to them who have obtained precious faith, just like we have, just like us. I want to share it with you. I want you to have that same faith. Why? Because Peter could remember whenever after Pentecost, when the power of God fell, yes, the devil tried to discourage him. Why? Because he was thrown in jail. Yes, they cut off James's head, and they saw that it pleased everybody, and so they set out to get Peter also, but they couldn't do it because it was on the Sabbath day, and so they put him in jail. They tied him to two guards, one on each side of him with a chain. And there he was, laying there that night, sound asleep. He wasn't worried about dying. Why not? Because he said, I know he didn't say it, but I'm saying it through his lips for that we might realize that God is still God. If the devil is able to take my life right now, it's just a shortcut for me to go to heaven. Just a shortcut. I won't have to worry anymore. But Jesus had already told him. He said, "Peter, when you're young," he said, "you can gird yourself and go where you want to. But he says, when you get older, others will gird you and take you where you don't want to go." What was he meaning? And Peter, I believe he realized that as he laid there that night, sound asleep. And an angel of God came into the prison with all of the guards and everything standing around outside. He made his appearance, and whenever he came in, Peter was sleeping so sound that the angel reached down and smote him on the side and said, "Peter, get up, put on your shoes and follow me." Well, praise God. My. And can't you imagine? Peter looked at him and says, "Look at this. Look at all these chains. I've got two on my hands. I've got two on my feet." He said, "Don't worry about chains. Just get up." So when Peter got up, the chains fell off. And he said, "Gird your coat around you and follow me." And so Peter threw his coat around and put his shoes on. And the angel started walking out. And Peter was right behind him. And those doors that was locked, whenever they put Peter in, they made sure those doors was locked. And whenever the angel walked up before the door just swung open. And the angel walked out, and Peter right behind him. That's the God that I serve. That's the one that Peter was referring to. And when he said, "I'm his servant, I'm his slave, I'll go where he wants me to go, I'll do what he wants me to do, I don't care what it is, I'll do it." And said, when they come to the big iron gate that went out into the street, there was four guards out there, watching that gate, guarding that gate. But you see, whenever the angel walked up, that old gate just swung open on its own, and they walked down into the street. I can picture Peter looking around and... Well, glory, Brother Ron, I believe he saw them old boys laying there sound asleep. And he began to follow the angel down the street. And as he was following that angel down the street, he says, wow, I know for sure this thing's real. I thought I was having a dream, but this thing's real. And the angel went off and left him. And Peter went to Mary's house. He went to Mary's house. So you see, my God can use us if we will allow him to. But we've got to submit our ways to God's ways because it's God's ways what counts. I might be able to do a few things by myself, but they wouldn't amount to nothing. And so when God says, follow after me, you see, we want to follow him. And I remember then, as that time went on, was more added to the church as the days passed by. And they was all gathered together in the temple. And as Peter and the others were walking down the street, they said they brought their sick and laid them along the side of the street. And just perhaps as Peter walked by, his shadow would fall on them and they would be healed. I know people don't believe that today. They think it's foolishness. But God said, I have chose the foolish things to confound the wise. And so you see, God knows exactly what he's doing. He doesn't have to ask somebody else to make him a plan, to draw him up a plan. He's got a plan all of his own. And he said, it's not my will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so God wants you to come. And if you miss heaven, it's not God's fault. I know there's a lot of people, they blame God for a lot of things, but honey, can I tell you today, it's not God's fault. Am I? Why? Because we've got a will all of our own, and God will not trespass on our will. And if we will to walk off and leave him, he'll allow us to do it. He doesn't want us to, but he'll allow us to do it. And so you see, today I believe that God wants to send an old-fashioned God sent Holy Ghost revival into the church, but the church is not ready for it. Why? Because most of the time, as you read over in the book of Revelation, he said that you're asleep. It's a sleeping church, and it's high time to awake out of our sleep, because the day is far spent, and the night is at hand. You see, the time that Jesus is coming back, it's at hand. I believe that. I believe that God gave me the message. I to tell everybody that Jesus is soon coming back again. And he says he's coming after a church without spot and without wrinkle. Not a little weak, emaciated church, but he said a powerful church. A church that's filled with the power and the glory of God. My. Honey, if people would see the glory of God, most of the time they'd be scared to death. They wouldn't know what to do. But if I could tell you, whenever back years ago, when I was just a young Christian, I went to the barn one night to pray until I could reach out and touch Jesus. I prayed until 5:30 the next morning. And honey, I can tell you the presence of God was in that place. I was afraid to move. And so I can tell you, people will look at me and they say, I'm not afraid of God. I say, honey, you haven't been close enough to him yet. One of these days you're going to have to face him. One day you're going to have to face him. And how will you do that? Will you be ashamed? Mama, will you be ashamed? Or will you say, okay, Lord, I've done all that I know to do at the time that I was doing it. I done the best that I could when I was doing it. And you see, if you'll do your best, there's nobody that can do any better. Oh, they might do a greater work than you, but they can't do it any better than you did because you did your best. And so you see, today's the day of salvation. Tomorrow might be eternity. And so he was writing to the people. I was precious faith. You see, faith is precious in the eyes of God. Why? Because that's what God requires of all of his people. He requires faith. Father, in the name of Jesus, reach out and touch those today under the sound of her voice. God, that they would look unto you because you're the author and the finisher of our faith. Have your way in our hearts. Forgive us, God, where we failed you, where we just sat down and didn't do anything. Let us get up and go about the Father's business. And we'll thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. God bless you. That is our prayer until this time next week.